Hello friends, welcome back to a new session. Today we are going to discuss about some facts about newborn, and all the things discussed today are very important. Each and every point is important. Only the main points are discussed here. So watch till the end and take down the notes, because these are all possible questions for your PSC examinations. So we'll start with newborn. Okay. So what is a tame baby? Tame baby is from 37th to 42nd gestational weeks. 37 to 42nd gestational weeks is called a tame baby. Then what is preterm? Preterm means less than 37 gestational weeks. Then late preterm is 32 to 37. Very preterm is 28 to 32. And extreme preterm is before 28 weeks. And postterm babies are after 42 gestational weeks. So at least remember term, preterm and postterm. Term baby means 37 to 42. Preterm means less than 37. And postterm means greater than 42 gestational weeks. Next is regarding the birth weight of newborn. Very important. The normal range of birth weight is 2.5 to 3.8 kg. So 2.5 to 3.8 kg. And LBW or low birth weight babies are infants less than 2.5 kg. That is 2500 gram. If it is less than that, they are called LBW. Then very low birth weight, that is VLBW, less than 1500 gram. And extremely low birth weight and ELBW, less than 1000 gram. And incredibly low birth weight is less than 750 gram. We are calling a baby, high risk baby, if the weight is less than 2 kg. If it is less than 2 kg, the baby is a high risk baby. Very important regarding the birth weight. Next is preterm babies. Who are preterm babies? We already told, baby of less than 37 weeks of gestational age is called a preterm baby. Then what are the characteristic features of a preterm baby? There will be fine hair, that is otherwise called a lanugo, covering the much of the body. Usually in a newborn, it will be very less. Lanugo is very less in a newborn, whereas a term newborn, whereas in a preterm baby, the lanugo will be much higher and it will be covering almost all over the body. So that is lanugo or fine hair. Then posture of complete relaxation. Usually infants will maintain a posture of complete flexion. Here there will be a complete relaxation. And there will be labored breathing or respiratory distress for the baby. Then there will be wrinkled skin. Because of the loss of subcutaneous fat, there will be wrinkled skin. Then slow ear recoil because of poor cartilage support. Then scrotum is empty in male babies and rugae is less prominent. Because the scrotum will descend only towards the 9th month, the baby's scrotum is not filled with testes. So that's why the scrotum is empty and the rugae of the testis is less prominent. Then labia minora exposed in female babies because of the loss of fat and more prone to hypothermia because of the absence of brown fat. So what is brown fat? Brown fat is the fat which will enable temperature regulation. So it's a brown adipose tissue. It helps in non-shivering thermogenesis. So this adipose tissue, brown adipose tissue, helps in non-shivering thermogenesis. This is seen in suprarenal, supraclavicular, pericardial and interscapular, also pancreatic areas. And this brown fat is usually absent in a newborn. That's why they are more prone to get hypothermia. That's it about brown fat. Very important. At least remember what is brown fat is and what is the function of brown fat. Then we will pass on to the immediate care of newborn at the time of birth. So immediately after delivery, we will dry the baby with warm towels or cloths. And we will ensure the airway is clear. Once the baby is crying, we will make the baby in a prone position to drain out all the secretions and remove the mucus and other material from the mouth and nose and throat with a suction pump if needed. And suctioning with a bulb syringe. And sometimes we will suction it with a bulb syringe. When baby cannot blow his or her nose, you may need to syringe it with a bulb syringe. The excess mucus has to be removed with a bulb syringe. If both mouth and nose need to be sucked, then the first thing is M and N. M followed by, in alphabetical order, just remember that first M, then N. So we will suck first mouth, then give suction to nose. That's the order of suction. First mouth, then nose. Then maintain body temperature. That's very important. There is chance for hypothermia in a newborn because of loss of temperature. Normal temperature regulation is absent in a newborn. So we have to cover the newborn adequately or keep the newborn under warmer. Then direction of rectal thermometer to be inserted while taking temperature in neonates is backward and downward. Backward and downward. The direction is very important. It can be asked as a question. Direction of thermal rectal thermometer when inserted into the rectum of a newborn, the direction is backward and downward. Next is regarding the care of umbilical cord. How do we care umbilical cord? The length of the umbilical cord is approximately equal to the crown rump length, CRL, of the fetus throughout pregnancy. So CRL will be measured during the ultrasound scan and all. So the approximately the length of umbilical cord is equivalent to CRL or crown rump length during the pregnancy time. And in a full-term neonate, it is usually about 50 centimeter or 20 inch long and about 2 centimeter in diameter, that is 0.75 inch in diameter. So that's very important, 50 centimeter and 2 centimeter diameter, 50 centimeter long, 2 centimeter diameter. Then after delivery, we will clamp and cut the umbilical cord with a sterile instrument, very important for preventing the infection. And using clamps or tapes, put the first eye about 5 to 7.5 centimeters from the base of the umbilical cord and cut the remaining cord. So only 5 to 7.5 centimeters is kept on the umbilicus base of the baby and rest is cut out. And observe for any oozing of blood from the clamped area. And do not apply any substance to the stump, umbilical stump. You should not apply any medication or anything or any kind of things on the umbilical cord. Then do not bind or bandage. Do not put any bandage over the umbilical stump. Then leave the stump uncovered. Umbilical cord will gradually dry up and become hard, stiff tissue and fall off within 5 to 10 days. And benefits of delayed clamping. Nowadays, we are advised to have a delayed clamping in newborns. Why it is so? In full-term infants, babies with delayed clamping had less anemia and iron deficiency during the first 3 to 6 months. The study states that there is less chance for anemia and iron deficiency during first 3 to 6 months in a newborn who is having delayed cord clamping. That's why we are doing delayed cord clamping. But sometimes there is chance for polycythemia and also there is chance for neonatal jaundice because of this. But the research findings are very minimal, so we cannot surely say, but in some instances it is found like that. Anyway, it is much more beneficial than having any harmful effects. Then prevention of ophthalmia neonatorum. So in earlier days, we will instill a few drops of silver nitrate solution or an antibiotic. So nowadays silver nitrate is not used. We will use some antibiotic ointment or solution to be instilled into the eye of infant to prevent any harmful organisms entering the eye of the baby during delivery. So in order to prevent any harmful organism entering the eye of the baby during delivery, we use some antibiotic ointment or instillations so that the eye infections are prevented. That's ophthalmia neonatorum is prevented. Then vitamin K administration, very, very important. So many questions are asked related to vitamin K administration. Why we are giving vitamin K administration? To prevent hemorrhage of the newborn. So we are giving vitamin K administration to prevent the hemorrhage of the newborn. And newborn is at risk for hemorrhagic disorders because of low prothrombin concentration during the initial days. So the liver is not mature. So the liver cannot synthesize prothrombin and other clotting factors initially. That's why the newborn is more prone to develop hemorrhagic disorders in the initial phase of their life. So we have to support the newborn to prevent the bleeding tendency. That's why we are administering vitamin K. So the coagulation factors synthesized in liver and it's depend upon vitamin K, which is not synthesized until intestinal bacteria are present. IM injection of vitamin K usually 0.5 to 1 milligram in the lateral aspect of middle third of vastus lateralis muscle. So that's also very important. The site of IM injection is the lateral aspect of middle third of vastus lateralis muscle. Then regarding the liver, it is large and but immature, but cannot destroy excessive RBC in the newborn, resulting in physiological jaundice by third day. And the lifespan of RBC in a newborn is around 80 days. In adults, it is around 120 days, whereas in a newborn, it is around 80 days. So very, very important points are highlighted in this slide. Very important. Any questions can come from this points already mentioned. Then regarding another important aspect, that is Apgar scoring. It is also a possible question. So who developed Apgar scoring? By Dr. Virginia Apgar. And the newborn's Apgar score is routinely assessed and recorded at 1 minute and at 5 minutes at after birth. And if it is not clear or it is not full even at 5 minutes, we will wait for 10 minutes if needed. And maximum score is 10. And if the newborn is having birth asphyxia, the score is usually 3 or less than 3. This is the scoring pattern of Apgar scoring. You can see the criteria and the scoring. Criteria, the scoring is 0, 1 and 2. For the respiration, if it is absent 0, slow 1 and good crying 2. Then heart rate absent 0, slow less than 100, 1. Then if it is greater than 100, okay, it is 2. Then muscle tone, if it is flaccid, then it is 0. Some flexion of extremity for 1. And active body movements 2. Reflex response, no response is 0. And grimace 1 and cry 2. Then skin color, if it is blue, 0. And body pink and blue extremities, that is called acrocyanosis. Cyanosis at the extremities, then it is 1. And whole body pink, if whole body is pink, then it is 2. So this is the Apgar scoring. So the criteria include respiration, heart rate, muscle tone, reflex response and skin color. So totally 5 are there, and maximum score for each category is 2. 5 into 2, total score maximum possible is 10. So 3 or less than 3 is possibility of. So 3 or less than 3 means there is a possibility of respiratory difficulty or birth asphyxia in a newborn. Then maximum score at first minute is 9, because during the first minute the child or infant having acrocyanosis, the extremities will be cyanosed in the first minute. That's why it is in the cyanosis aspect there will be point, will be one point will be less, the point will be maximum possible point will be 1. So that the total score possible at first minute is 9, and fifth minute it will be 10 normally. And if there is any delay, that is acrocyanosis, that is peripheral cyanosis of hand and feet, normal in the first few hours of the birth, and may be noted intermittently for the 7 to 10 days. So there is a possibility of acrocyanosis for about 7 to 10 days, and it is normal for a newborn. Then what are the peculiarity of the scoring and the interventions? So if the score is from 8 to 10, no intervention is required except support the newborn's spontaneous effort. So you have to just administer oxygen and suction the airway. That's only needed, and observe the infant if the infant is having score of 8 to 10. Then 4 to 7, then you have to stimulate the infant, that you have to rub the back, tap the lower extremity and administer oxygen to the newborn and rescore at specific intervals. That's at 5 and 10 minutes. Then if the score is 0 to 3, then requires full resuscitation. The newborn has to be resuscitated may have to be ventilated and rescore at specific individuals. Intervals. So rescore at specific intervals. Then regarding the vital signs. Heart rate is 120 to 160 beats per minute. Respiratory rate is 0 to 60 breaths per minute. And temperature axillary, the normal value is 36.5 to 37 degrees Celsius. And if there is less than 35 degrees Celsius, it is called hypothermia. So that's about the vital signs, normal vital signs for a newborn. Then regarding the blood values, Hb from 40 to 20 gram percentage. Then WBC count 6000 to 22000 cells per cubic millimeter, blood volume 80 ml per kg, RBC 5 million. So these are the blood values for a newborn, and we will discuss the changes in the newborn during the first week of life. Regarding the changes in the circulatory system, there will be closure of ramen ovale, closure of ductus arteriosus, and obliteration of the umbilical arteries within 1 hour after birth. So within 1 hour, closure of ramen ovale, closure of ductus arteriosus, and obliteration of umbilical arteries. Then heart rate is regular between 120 to 160 beats per minute, but there can be variability. Then there can be a soft murmur in the first month of life. So a soft murmur is possible in the first month of life, and it is usually considered normal. Then regarding the respiratory system, the pattern of respiration is usually diaphragmatic respiration, irregular and abdominal. So you can see the abdominal movements, and also there is some kind of pause and interval in between respiration. So it's irregular in nature, and maximum is 30 to 50 per minute, and it will be quiet with periods of apnea. There's chance of periods of apnea in between, and it is called irregular and abdominal respiration. Then excretory. Kidneys are immature. Newborn should void within the first 24 hours. You have to observe the newborn voiding in the first 24 hours. And if not, you have to report to the concerned person. Then bladder capacity of newborn is 15 to 20 ml. Urine output is minimum 150 ml per day for the newborn. And should the newborn should pass stool within 12 to 48 hours of the birth. This also is very important. The first stool is called meconium. So this has to be passed within 12 to 48 hours of birth, and if not, have to be reported. Then first stool black, green, and tenacious meconium. So the name of the first stool is meconium. It is black, green, and tenacious. And by third day, it will become highest yellow. So that is the character of change in the color of newborn's feces. Then regarding the digestive system, the cardiac sphincter of the stomach is not well developed. So there is chance for regurgitation. So we have to burp the infant after each breastfeed. Then all newborns normally lose around 10% of their body weight in the first week of their life because of water loss through evaporation. And expected weight loss for a newborn is 30 gram per day for first 10 days. So weight loss is 30 gram per day for first 10 days. So what is the stomach capacity of the newborn? It is 30 ml. All these values are very important. Please try to remember all these values. Then regarding the endocrine system, there is chance for enlargement of breast in boys, that is called gynecomastia, and in girls. These are now considered normal. And in female babies, there is a chance for menstrual like vaginal bleeding that occur after 3 to 4 days after the birth. It is due to withdrawal of maternal hormones in the newborn's body. That is called pseudo-menstruation. Pseudo-menstruation. So these two things are normal and possible. Then regarding the integumentary system, there is vernix caseosa, that is a cheesy white covering on the body of the infant during or at birth. Then lanugo, we already discussed, it's fine hair, and it is usually commonly seen in preterms. Then milia, it's a yellow or white spots on the nose, and small white sebaceous glands appear on the forehead, nose, chin, and they disappear by around first few weeks. And Mongolian spots, these are large blue patches of pigment over the lumbar area, buttocks or extremities, and disappear in first 6 months to 1 year. Then regarding another important point, that is caput succedaneum. It's a subcutaneous and extra periosteal fluid collection. It's a subcutaneous and extra periosteal fluid collection. And caput succedaneum is edema of the soft tissue over bone, and it crosses over the suture line. So it's an edema of soft tissue over the bone, and it crosses the suture line because it does not come under the periosteum. It's above the periosteum in the soft tissue area. So it will cross the suture line of the bone, and it will subside in a few days. It's produced as a result of strained birth or some kind of instrumental delivery, and it is common in newborns, and it will subside within a few days. And whereas another similar category is called cephalhematoma. And what is cephalhematoma? It is subperiosteal collection of blood, that is under the periosteum. There is a rupture of so small periosteal vessels will cause collection of blood under the periosteum, usually common around the parietal bone. And cephalhematoma is a swelling caused by bleeding into an area between bone and its periosteum. It does not cross over the suture line, and it is usually absorbed within 6 weeks with no treatment. Then brachial plexus injuries. First one is Erb Duchenne palsy or Erb's palsy, very common during, if it is the person or the child is having shoulder dystocia, an obstruction of shoulder delivery. But shoulder injury, brachial plexus injury causes, there is shoulder and elbow paralysis, and there will be a turning inward of the extremity, which is called waiter's tip or policeman receiving tip position, and the prognosis is good. Then another palsy is called Klumke's palsy. It is, the narrow root is C7 and C8. There is weakness of wrist and hand. There is no grasp reflex possible in these people. And another thing is ipsilateral Horner syndrome, when there is an involvement of T1 segment, narrow segment. Then signs are meiosis, that is constriction of pupil, partial ptosis, that is a partial drooping of the eyelid. Then sudden death, infant death syndrome, that is SIDS. It is an unexplained death, usually during sleep, seemingly healthy baby less than a year old. And SIDS is sometimes known as crib death. It's very important point, crib death is SIDS, SIDS. Autopsy fails to demonstrate adequate cause of death, and SIDS might be associated with defects in the portion of an infant's brain that controls breathing and arousal from sleep. Then next one is shaken baby syndrome. It's a serious brain injury resulting from forcefully shaking an infant or toddler. Usually occurs when a parent or caregiver severely shakes a child in frustration or anger. There is a permanent brain damage or death may be possible in such a kind of baby. So that's all about a brief idea regarding the main points related to newborn, which may come for your PSC or any kind of multiple choice examinations. Study well, work hard, and achieve your aim. If you have not subscribed this channel, kindly subscribe so that you will be able to get notifications regarding the coming videos. And study well. Once again, wish you a good luck. Thank you.